Porsche in Frankfurt. Thank you so much. We appreciate it. Good luck.
Right, that was Rush, and just for the record, I fucking hate Rush, but that's the only song in there is like, man, they're a power trio, so we had to have a power trio because we are the Friday Night Power Trio, even though right now we're a sexually ambiguous duo right now, Brooks, with those
dynamic duo
arms you got. Blake is coming. He's a little late. He's running a little late. Maybe we'll make 6:15 to start on a regular basis here. I don't know. What do you think, Brooks? Anyway, it's great to be with you guys. We're both happy to be here. Yes, I did. I noticed the chat. Yes, I did cancel earlier because Brooks said he had a concert to go to tonight with his daughter. But then he found out, Brooks, it's Monday.
It's Monday. Friday. We're all right. We're clear for Friday.
So we can do a show. So I hastily scrambled together and put this together, and TV's Blake Wally is going to be joining us. Do I echo a lot? It sounds like there's an echo in here because, as you can see, everything, all kinds of stuff is off the walls. Everything is moved. The giant desk and credenza from back there got moved. Oh, my God, did they weigh a ton. And, Brooks, you've been doing a lot of work on your new place, and I just got to tell you, you don't feel your age until you have to lift something that's 200 pounds. Then you feel your age. So it sucks, but I'm glad to be here. I survived that. That was a week ago now. It feels like yesterday. And getting ready for the big move. So we only have a few shows left. By the way, this is the Friday Night Fun Time Power Trio show with myself, Mike Barrett, in Seattle, Washington. Tonight, Brooks, I am drinking what I've been drinking lately, which is my Glenrannoch Scotch whiskey that I got from my wonderful friend over there in Scotland.
Can't go wrong there, mate.
I can't remember you. Oh, sweetheart, I'm sorry, I just forgot your name, just slipped out of my head. This also happens when you're up there in age, but I will go. I mean I can see your face, I can see us posing together for the picture, but I can't remember her name off the top of my head. Anyway, Rumble is working. Is Rumble working? Let's check if Rumble's working. Anyway, that's what I'm drinking tonight. Brooks, what are you drinking over there somewhere east of the Carolinas?
I'm drinking not Bud Light.
Not Bud Light, okay.
Modelo, the number one beer in the country right now.
All right. Yeah, it is the number one beer in the country right now because we all know that Budweiser is no longer the number one beer in the country for reasons that are quite clearly obvious. Okay, guys, welcome to the show. I'm guessing TV's Blake Wally's going to be drinking box wine when he gets here. My order dinner is supposed to be here, but I don't know. I don't know if it's here or not because the picture doesn't appear to show that it's here. Dog didn't go crazy. All right. Anyway, big news week this week, as usual. It is kind of insane. And once again, they have tried to indict Donald Trump in order to keep him from running for president again.
So good. So sweet.
This is the kind of complete nonsense that goes on in countries like third world countries like Brazil and Venezuela. It goes on in communist countries. It doesn't happen in the United States, but it is happening in the United States. And Brooks, what makes my blood boil is the number of libtard Democrats. And that's the only kind of Democrat there is. If you're a Democrat, you're either a Satanist, a pervert, or a complete retard. That's it. There's no anybody who votes for any Democrat at any level, right down to dog catcher. You're one of those three things. And we need to get you the fuck out of this country so we can get on with returning it to what it's supposed to be, which is a constitutional republic. So I've never seen anything so insane. And basically, it's funny because as some analysts have talked about it, Brooks, they said that basically if this were to go through, and, you know, of course, if he's tried in Washington, D.C., he'll be convicted no matter what, because it's like literally 99% Democrats there. So it's a show trial. It's a kangaroo court. It's Stalin-esque. It's as bad as Nazi Germany. And I guess what I want to get is your thoughts on this, because if they actually get this through, then we are no better than any of those countries we've talked about before. And there's literally no law left in the United States. And, you know, you've had some experience with that lately. You got your Twitter account deleted for absolutely no fucking reason. Maybe you can have an X account, though. Maybe your Twitter account got deleted, but you can have an X account. What do you think?
No, it was shortly after it switched to X, they got it. But listen, this lawsuit is actually a big, juicy opportunity. There are a couple things. I agree with Alan Dershowitz on this one, on the face of it. The indictment itself, it's about 35 pages long and some fluff, but it mentions two public communications in the form of tweets that President Trump sent out. However, the tweets are incomplete. Mr. Jack edited the tweets.
Yeah.
And this is lying in an indictment.
It's criminal.
It could backfire on Jack. The second thing is, anytime you file a lawsuit in federal court, the other side has discovery. That's the way our court system works. And I guess Jack, being a libtard, didn't realize that for the first time, and believe me, it's been tried, 23 states tried to do this and couldn't do it. For the first time, the 2020 election is now in court.
Yeah.
And the Trump team is now going to file for discovery, and they're going to pull all that fraudulent information that the courts wouldn't listen to because these states had no standing, right? Now it's going to be introduced in a criminal case. It's all going to be part of the record. And he may have just handed the 2020 election to President Trump.
The thing, though, that bothers me about that, and that I don't buy into, I don't get, is that we've heard this crap over and over again. When he was indicted for the false charges in New York, we heard that same crap. Oh, guess what? Now he gets to bring a new court. The courts are corrupt. You know, there is a penalty in the law, under common law, for judges that are corrupt. And I'm not going to say what it is, because some people are saying my YouTube channel is not working right now. It's not on Rumble. I don't know. Okay, I'll have to check. It was there just a second ago when I looked at it. But Brooks, if they're corrupt, there is a penalty for that. And until that penalty is imposed on at least one judge who's violating his oath, I don't think anything's going to change. So I think that this is going to go on. They're going to come in. There's going to be a trial. Trump can present all the evidence he wants, and the American people can believe it all they want. And I believe probably 70% of America knows the 2020 election was stolen. But unless somebody with a gun enforces the law, the real law of this country, and these people pay a price, what's going to change? I think they're just going to convict him, throw him in jail, and try to kill him. From where I'm sitting, that's what my expectation.
That's the worst that can happen. But, you know, as long as we have a legal system in this country, and I'm not going to say we have a rule of law, we have the rule by law, but there are things that have to happen a certain way in the courtroom. And if they don't happen a certain way, it's called a mistrial.
Okay. But that's if the law is followed. And I don't believe the law is going to be followed. If the law was being followed, this wouldn't be even a case. The judge is an Obama judge. She's going to push it through. She should throw this out on its face right now. She should say, no, this is all complete bullshit. And he's protected under this and that. But she's not going to do that. There was a time when judges acted with integrity, but she's not going to do that. So, I mean, you can talk about all these legal things all you want, but in reality, I mean, is that really going to happen? And so what if he proves in court the 2020 was stolen. We all know it was. The evidence is overwhelming. Anybody, all you have to do is look at the vote graph, you know, the vertical blue line, and that's fraud right there by itself. You don't need anything else. Anybody who knows what trend curves look like, organic trend curves, you know that that's theft right there. That's fraud. It's the only explanation for it. What difference does it make? Unless somebody with a gun enforces it like they did in 1776, I don't see it's going to make a difference at all. Am I wrong?
Well, no, you're not wrong. But that was it was so funny. Al Sharpton today saying, you know, what would have happened if Madison would have overthrown the government? It was called the Revolutionary War, asshole.
What would happen if Madison and Jefferson? Yeah, it's Frick TV's Blake Wally in there. Blake, sorry to keep you back there. I was on a roll for a second. Why don't you tell everybody what you're drinking tonight and how you're doing?
I am doing well. Sorry I was late. Busy. But it's great to be here, and I am on my box of Liberty Creek Merlot. And since I was in such a hurry, I'm just going to drink it right out of the box.
There you go. Not even poured into a glass. All right. I guess what I want to do is get – you heard the conversation, most of the conversation between Brooks and I and where I'm at and where he's at. And I'm just saying I don't see it makes any difference what the legal process is dead in this country because the judges are all corrupt. The police are all corrupt. The Department of Justice is corrupt. The FBI is corrupt. I mean, it's all dead, and I just don't see anything changing until, like I said, somebody with a gun makes it change. So am I wrong, and are you more optimistic? And then I want to get your comment on Al Sharpton's comments. Did you hear those? Al Sharpton? Okay.
Oh, I wasn't sure if you were asking me or not. So
I'm bringing it into the conversation. Anyway.
Sure. These people have nothing left to lose anyway. Whether they commit further crimes or not, they're still equally, you know, have every incentive to keep this going as long as possible, and they have to stay in power for that to happen. So they're going to do everything they can to, jail or destroy their opposition, which is happening right now. And yeah, it was interesting. I didn't know Al Sharpton still had his show. So I did see that clip, but I thought that was from something like years ago, like buried in the archive. I didn't know he was still around doing that stupid politics show. But yeah, he got busted because he doesn't know any better, because it's just, he sees the Democrats continually saying democracy, 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 and it's not. It's a constitutional republic. They need civics lessons.
The complete ignorance of something like that. It's like literally Jefferson and Madison were part of the Revolutionary War against the government of the time.
Wow.
The British government, the very same type of government we're existing with right now. What a complete fucking clown. I mean, what a fucking clown that guy is. And he's just being, you know, he's just being ratioed and mocked on Twitter. So, okay. So that aside, I mean, what do you think about this process now, this new fake Trump indictment? It's just, to me, it's just, I'm just so sick of this. I'm like, when are the cowards who are supposed to be on our side, if they even exist, going to act? And I mean, on the one hand, I have Jen telling me, yeah, they're out there. Yeah, there really is a plan. What the fuck is the plan? I mean, it's ridiculous. How much longer is this going to go on, I wonder, before something actually gets done?
Well, I think that's what they're doing, is they're firing every gun they have in the room, and now the public sees them for who they are and sees Jack for who he is and sees these cases for what they are, and it's just making Trump more popular. And now he's not going to attend the debates. I mean, he wasn't going to attend them anyway because he's so far ahead. It would be just give whoever debated against him a boost. So he's just going to let them have their little echo chamber, and he'll continue to rock on. They want to accomplish taking him off the rally trail, because as long as he's rallying, the movement continues.
Yeah.
And so what they want is to get him in court and tie him up and maybe even jail him under January 6th and then hold him without bail. And I think they even tried to introduce a bill to forbid him from conducting rallies because they said they were insurrection.
Well, just like after Mike Pence refused to challenge the votes that he and everybody else knew were fraudulent, they passed a law to change it so the vice president couldn't reject electoral votes. Well, then then what's the whole point of the Electoral College process then?
Right.
If there's no transparency.
For the record, what happened is Arizona stepped forward and they said, we're not ready. We're not ready. There was the Supreme Court that made changes to our election system. The legislature wasn't involved. We can't really trust these results. So we're going to enter this protest, and a congressman has signed it and a senator has signed it. And so Mike Pence said, well, in that case, then this meeting's adjourned and you all can go back and start analyzing your data and come back when you have the answer. That's when Nancy Pelosi left the podium and had the Capitol Police open the doors.
And start the fake insurrection.
Right. Well, the reason she did that is she had to declare a state of emergency so she could interrupt it before the next state came up and said, we want to do the same thing as Arizona did, which I think was going to be Georgia. And that also took any debate off the floor. They just came back in and read off what they had certified by the Secretary of State. But these six states violated their own state laws in their own election. They violated their own election laws because the Secretary of State or the Supreme Court in that state made changes to the election process and allowed votes to come in 6, 7, 8 days after the election.
Yeah, which they had no authority to do. Exactly. I mean, the mechanics of the fraud are so clear and so obvious. You've got 2,000 mules. You've got the votes changing right on screen, which are linked up to the computers where the computers were changed. You've got the physical fraud. You've got the ballot stuff. You've got the charts and graphs showing complete impossibilities. You've got districts where more people than actually lived in the districts voted in the district, which is pretty amazing. Pretty amazing. You can have a district with only, let's say 500,000 people in it, and then 750,000 people vote, and all done in the dead of night.
Or send out 1.2 million mail-in ballots, and you get 1.8 million back.
Okay. So, Blake. What do you think is going to happen with this? I mean, I believe they're going to, like you said, they're trying to, like Brooks says, they're going to try to get Trump in court, and they're going to order, the judge is going to issue some order for him not to speak, not to tweet, not to truth, something like that to keep him from communicating.
Some That's gag what order.
Going to happen. Yep. And I got to be honest with you, I have no faith in him at this point, because every time a fucking judge has done that, he's rolled over for them. Where it started was when Jim Acosta got kicked out of the White House press room, actually assaulted a female staffer who was holding a microphone that she was trying to take back. And some fucking judge says, oh no, you have to let him back in. And let's face reality. The president and the president alone has control over who gets press credentials in the White House. And right then and there, when Trump didn't say, fuck you, Mr. Judge, I control who gets into my White House, not you. And ever since then, he's caved into everything the federal courts have told him to do. I mean, I never would have even gone to this arraignment the other day. I just said, fuck you, come and get me. Let's see if you can fight your way through my personal security. But he doesn't do any of that. So my belief is they're going to put a gag order on him and he's going to gag. Please tell me I'm wrong, Blake.
Yeah, I did see that. He is going to put the gag, or at least threaten to put the gag on. So I don't know. It depends. Maybe he's going to listen to his advisors on that. But I think if they're ready to actually throw him in jail, go above and beyond, then maybe he will just say fuck off and won't show up that day. And nor should he. This is completely unprecedented process. This is banana republic stuff. They're going after their political enemy. And yes, they'd love to silence him and hold him there. And yeah, they can just, control the election where maybe they can have Biden run free and clear against whoever their other establishment pick is, DeSantis or Pence or something like that. That would be awful. But and then of course they're changing the rules. And a bit back in like 92 when they changed the rules because Perot was a big threat to the establishment. So now you don't have third parties in the debate. Every time the establishment gets rattled, they do something like that. And yeah, we got to be careful because it's time to go on the offense. So they're going to start just picking us off one by one. It'll start with Trump and then everybody else. So it's time we all hang together or they're going to hang us all separate. So that seems to be the plan. Go for broke.
That seems dangerous. Yeah, you have no idea how really right you are. What all the other candidates for president should do at this point is withdraw and throw all their support behind Trump.
Yeah, but they're not going to do that because they're all paid off by the deep state. Chris Christie just went. He just went to fucking Ukraine. Chris Christie, who's polling at what 0%? It's the same shape as his body. The percentage is like this. It's round. Went to Ukraine to talk about how great Zelensky was. And of course, he took a payoff. He brought it back in his diplomatic bag, probably cash payout to go collect his money from Soros and Zelensky. So it's like they're not going to do any of that. They want him gone, too, because he's exposing how corrupt the Republican Party is just as much as he's exposing the Democrats. So how's that going to work? I mean, you think that's I don't know. I feel at this point, I don't hate to be pessimistic, but I'm like, let's go to war with these guys. There's more of us than there are of them. Why are we sitting on our hands? Why are we keeping our powder dry if we're never going to use it? And I don't know. Anybody see any particular pressure coming to a head? Or
well, we did have
Trump, every time Trump gives in, it just diffuses the whole pushback energy.
We did have the woman from the DOJ who was on a talk radio or talk TV program, and she said that the Department of Defense had all this information about the fraud, but they were afraid if they released it, it would start a civil war. And I'm like, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And your point is, this needs to happen.
The problem with that is?
The Corporation of the United States of America is insolvent. Every country in the world knows it except ours.
Right. And on August 22nd, it's going to go bye-bye. But, if there's a plan, Blake, I don't see it. Do you see it?
Not quite anymore. So I'm just waiting for 2024. And if there's a shady election again, then it might be time to, we have to have a plan in place. I'm happy to accept election results if they can be transparent and show us. I don't think that's happening. But, that's kind of the red line, I do believe, if they try to push this one. Or else it's going to be too late. We're not going to wait till 2028. We don't have four more years to spend waiting on good guys something to happen. It's clearly.
No, I agree with you 100% on that. And the reality, Blake, is that, look, if they don't do something by October 1st, I'm just going to stop. I'm going to quit doing anything about changes, because change is not going to happen. If they're going to do something against these people, and I hear from connected folks that they are, 2 weeks, a week ago Friday, it was 2 weeks. Now it's next Thursday. I guarantee you next Thursday, it's always a week from now that something's going to start happening, right? And it never fucking does. But if they don't act against these people to remove them in a decisive way, I don't mean some, we're going to start an impeachment investigation. I mean, remove the traitorous motherfuckers. If they don't do that, then I think that they're just treading water until 2024, when I think it's just going to get stolen again. And I'm not sitting by for that.
No, me neither. I think 2018, they cheated. 2020, they cheated. 2022, they cheated.
Yeah.
And they're going to cheat again in 2024.
Well, and don't kid yourself. They cheated in 2016, too. But Trump's vote was so overwhelming that he won anyway. And believe me, the numbers, I've heard inside about the real numbers, and Trump won by a lot more than they say he won by.
I mean, when you look at 2,837 counties compared to less than 500, it wasn't even close. It wasn't even close.
Yeah.
And that's the problem that we have, is somehow they have sold the American people on the idea of something called a blue state. There's no such thing.
Yep.
Blue states don't exist.
Yep.
Only blue cities exist.
Mm-hmm.
And these
organized crime syndicates, let's just call it what it is, a RICO violation. These organized crime outfits run the cities like they used to run New York, like they used to run Chicago. They run all these blue cities, and those blue cities dominate the states. Usually it's the capital of the state that has become corrupt. The rest of the state is red, and whether it's Virginia or Illinois or California or Massachusetts, it's the capital city that's blue, and that's what dominates everything.
What needs to happen is red counties need to start seceding from states. Just go
like Oregon. They're trying to go into Idaho.
Yeah, just say we secede. We're seceding. We're going to join up with the neighboring state, Washington, Oregon, whatever. We're now part of them.
Well, they need to do what Abbott's doing right now. Abbott put up the floating buoys in the middle of the Rio Grande, and Biden said, take them down. And Abbott said, see you in court, Mr. President. Yeah. They're staying.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's...
And by the way, I think it's 12 states now have sent their National Guards to Texas to stand on the border.
Well, good for them. And that's something that's not too bad. All right. Yeah. In other news, fat, disgusting blob, pile of shit, Bill Barr came out of the attack Donald Trump again. And I keep hearing this shit about how, oh, Bill Barr is really on our side. He's just playing a role. Well, he's playing it a little too well. As Mark Levin, who I don't trust either, put it, Bill Barr grows more contemptible by the day, and his ignorance of the law and the Constitution is shocking. You will count me as very shocked if it turns out that Bill Barr is a good guy, because everything that he's doing says he's a piece of shit. He looks like Elton John, for one thing. Only he makes Elton look skinny, though. And, you know, four of a kind, Bill Barr, Judas, I don't know. Who's that? I don't know. Caligula, I don't know. And Benedict Arnold. He's a traitor. And what I don't get, I guess, is what do you guys think? But let's start with you, Blake.
Yeah.
What is this guy's game? I mean, he, on the one hand, he gave some very solid interviews before the election saying how this situation is ripe for fraud, and explained very clearly how all the fake paper ballots and all that was going to result in fraud and how they were going to steal the election. And then after the election, he did absolutely nothing about it. So do you think this is really who he is? He's always been a Bushite, or do you think that he's a double agent of some kind?
I'd have to say he's the Bush guy. Always have. And there's a quote. I just pulled up an article that I had where he says Bill Barr says he will jump off a bridge if Donald Trump wins the 2024 nomination.
Well, then let's pray for that. Let's pray for Trump to win the nomination. Yeah.
That tells you maybe he's so corrupt and they're going to come after him and he doesn't want all that stuff to come out, or how he helped the deep state turn against Trump. Yeah, it's sad to see some of these people, or Mike Pompeo, like all of those top advisors that he had around him, all those like neocon snakes. Yeah, they're all coming after him. It's awful.
All right. I was looking for the if you don't trust me on the on the bar comparison, I was looking for this. What do you think about that, guys?
Nice.
I think we showed that last week. So, and Potato or Amy Schumer? Okay. All right. So we're good with that. All right. So
I think the comparison's a little better than what you think, because I think Bill Barr has been given hand jobs in the cloakroom for a long time. He is a big glad hander. He's a big donor schmoozer, and he will do whatever it takes, whatever the deep state tells him to do, he will do. He's totally compromised. And I don't care if anybody knows I said he gives hand jobs in the cloakroom, because I think that's exactly what the guy's been doing.
Wow. Okay, so thank you for that. Hang on, I'm looking for something here. All right, so let's shift gears a little. Oh, I'm still sharing. I didn't realize I was still sharing. If you don't know what a deep state psyop looks like, you're looking at it. This is Jeremy Corbell, George Knapp, Fravor, Grush, and the other guy, I forget his name, the other pilot, and Charles McCullough, and also involved in this was James Clapper. We discussed this a little bit last week. I think the UFO hearings, even though I was lucky enough to be on Fox and Friends Did you guys see that? I was on Fox and Friends.
Yeah,
I did.
Yeah.
On Saturday morning, very proud of myself. And thank you, Tom Reed, my buddy Tom Reed, because Tom Reed got me on with Jesse Waters, which got me this Fox and Friends thing. And I just don't trust these hearings at all on extraterrestrials and UFOs. And I know, Brooks, you've got some thoughts on this too. I kind of want to get another take like we did last week, but reinforce it. The more I think about this, it bothers me. The more I think about this, the more clear it becomes to me that this is a deep state narrative. I just wonder where you think it's going.
Well, I think it's like, what is it, Randy Savage? It's going nowhere.
Yeah.
Okay. That's exactly where it's going. It's just put out there because they couldn't come up with a school shooting quick enough. It was just put out there to cover the Hunter Biden story, trying to get enough people to watch the UFO thing so they won't watch the Hunter Biden story. And I think you were dead right on the money on Fox and Friends by saying, look, everything he said is 70 years old. We've known about this for a long time. What are they doing? Just reading the script from X-Files? What was it, Scully? Is it Mulder? Which line is that?
Yeah.
That's exactly what they were doing. They didn't tell us anything new. They didn't show any pictures. They didn't name any names. They didn't tell us anything new. And the thing that was the most disappointing is that Mace and Burchett are, all those guys, they didn't ask any follow-up questions.
Yeah, Matt Gaetz didn't. Yeah, well, I mean, I'm the most disappointed, Blake, that AOC didn't ask any good follow-up questions. That's my girlfriend. That's my future wife, is AOC. We all know that, right? I no longer have to take her to Vegas and fuck all the stupid out of her. She can just come to Vegas. I'm just going to live there. Just come on, visit me.
Oh, yeah.
I'll fuck all the stupid out. Did I say that out loud? I'll F all the stupid out. Yeah. I actually was rather impressed with AOC. I thought she did a pretty good job. And everybody says she's an actress and she's reading from a script. But I thought, you know, she asked some good questions. Now, do you think there's any other agenda, Blake, that I feel like they're going to use this to leverage money out of the corporations, because they kept talking about the defense contractors. They know this. And where do they get all this money? It felt like that's what the essence of this is. Do you think I'm a little off on that? Like, are they just using these hearings to put pressure on the corporations, the defense industry, to give them more donations? Or do you think that there's something legitimate behind, like, is there a legitimate curiosity?
I don't think so. Or maybe there's general curiosity for normies or people that aren't familiar with this stuff. And maybe that sounds like kind of a big deal to hear that. But yeah, for you guys, for me, I've, you know, been looking at this stuff for 30 years too, since the X-Files and many other places I've been doing research on that. And there wasn't anything new or exciting. So it was just a show trial for everybody. And there's always probably a element to make money, I'm sure. It's tied into it as well. So they've all had this black budget, or how they funnel all this money. That's said even in the movie Independence Day, how they overcharge, or how they find these black budgets or what have you. So no, I don't trust any of it. And yeah, this also could be the distraction. We've had also with the Trump indictments, every time the walls start closing in on Hunter and Joe and their business dealings, then all of a sudden they drop the hammer. So it's like, oh, they were going to indict. They sent them on Sunday night, and then we're waiting and waiting for them to do something. And then as soon as the Devin Archer thing comes out, oh, yeah, then they get to indict Trump and dominate the news cycle again. So, same playbook.
That's the thing. That's a good point. I mean, people say, well, the hearings were just a distraction from the other stuff from Hunter Biden, but the Trump indictment was a distraction from Hunter Biden. So what's the UFO hearings about? And I don't know. There's definitely an agenda. I mean, the fact that Fox had me on to talk about it, I think, is a major growth thing. We got to get Brooks on there. And you know, it's too bad, because I was hoping there'd be a third time for a third question. It was 4 minutes. I'll tell you, that goes by really fast. I mean, I gave two answers and we were out of there. I was hoping for a third question, because I was going to say, you know, until we get people like Tom Reed and Whitley Strieber and Travis Walton and Brooks Agnew and, you know, Dr. Bob Wood to testify in front. Bob Wood's been investigating UFOs since the 1960s, when I think it was I want to say Hughes Corporation, asked him, I forget who he was working for, asked him to go find out if UFOs were real. And guess what? You got a $2 million budget and hired Stanton Friedman to help him and be his chief investigator. That's how Stan got started in the whole thing. So, I mean, if there's anybody that knows more about what's going on, then these people ought to know. How about the testimonies of Clifford Stone? I mean, I'm correcting people on UFO Twitter all the time, because they're like, oh, well, you know, David Grush says there are crash retrieval programs. Yeah, Clifford Stone told you that in 1989.
Exactly.
He was on them. I mean, and he's a legitimate guy. He's passed away, but we could enter his testimony, his story into the congressional record. Robert O. Dean, another guy who saw the assessment, the 2-foot-tall book of human alien interactions. It's like, to me, it's like, it's a kangaroo court, a show trial. But I'm trying to figure out for what, to make AOC look smart? And what is it with AOC and Gates? There's something happening. I don't know what it is, but Matt, you better stay away from my girl or you're going to be in big trouble.
Well, somebody just needs to ask the question. Okay, Mr. Grush, you say there was a crash and there was a ship recovered and they were evidently occupants, operators in the ship. First question. Yeah. Where is the ship? Where's the ship right now, today? Where's that ship? Mm-hmm. And don't tell me it's classified. This committee has oversight. Nothing is classified in this meeting.
I agree with that 100%. And Blake, that's the whole thing I'm saying about how scripted it was. That's the first question. Nobody asked that question. We've always had this thing. Richard Hoagland and I, who I worked with for 10 years, wrote that great book, Dark Mission, with. We've always argued that the reason NASA will never admit that there are ruins of an ancient extraterrestrial civilization, I'm not saying alien, I'm saying extraterrestrial, which means not from the Earth, that's all it means, could be human, could be alien, but there's ruins all over Mars, there's ruins all over the moon. And the reason NASA will never admit that fact is because if they're at a press briefing, somebody's going to ask the question, well, excuse me, there's a super highly advanced civilization that used to be on Mars. What happened to them? But now, after these hearings, I'm thinking maybe nobody would ask that question, Blake.
Yeah.
Is everything so fake now that we can't trust anything?
Yeah, it's sad. There's just no curiosity, because we should. Not just even Mars, but also with the ancient structures that are all over the planet, right, or what could be hiding out in Antarctica. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of things to look at. And a lot of the archaeologists, they don't even want to talk about that. So I guess you can't even mention something like Atlantis or you'll be like laughed out of the place. And there's so many cool places to dig or to do, these archaeological discoveries, and nobody seems to care. It's just like they're covering all of that up and they just want the people to be just, dumb and manageable. So that's easier for them to control the population. And if they really had something cool to say at some of these hearings, it would have been behind closed doors. The names you mentioned, they would never allow them to just speak freely publicly, I don't think.
And why I would never be there. I would never be asked to talk about what I knew about stuff because, well, first of all, I don't have inside classified information, but also because they'd be afraid I might tell the truth in front of them. And that's the thing is that what I'm getting at, Blake, I guess I didn't really set it up very well. Is it struck me that what Brooks just said and what I'm talking about, these are the natural questions, but they weren't asked. So that means the questions and answers were pre-scripted, which probably they are a lot of the time, but then pre-scripted for what reason? Any thoughts or speculations on that? I mean, you think they're setting up the alien invasion? What are they doing?
Oh, that's a good possibility. Yeah, because it's always the Operation Blue Beam that's sitting in their playbook waiting for the Hail Mary they got to pull out. So I don't know. Yeah, it could be part of that. It's what they call that.
It's a psi-op.
Predictive programming,
right.
Yeah, so they'll stick with it, and then they'll put some fake stuff in there, and then when people mention anything, they'll be easy to discredit, so...
I'm just telling you, Blake, you're the youngin' on this, and you can't start having, you cannot start having senior moments like me and Brooks when it comes to remembering people's names. And I said, Polly, Polly. Okay. Polly gave me this. Paul. Okay, Polly, I forgot your last name, but I remember your first name is Polly. Polly gave me this. Thank you.
Nice.
Cheers. All right. So I guess I have another question that I think is important and relevant. I want to show this picture for you guys from Ukraine before we get into Brooks's Ukraine report. And here's the picture. Chris Christie and Vladimir Zelensky wearing his Ukraine branded t-shirt. So I have a question for you guys, and this is a serious question, and I want a serious answer. Who do you think is fatter, Bill Barr, Chris Christie, or Jerry Nadler? Brooks?
Oh, that's a tough one. See, Jerry Nadler and Chris Christie both had their stomachs stapled so that they keep from falling over.
How can they still be so fat?
Yeah, because Christie fell off the wagon. See, he's still eating the bonbons and the M&M, peanut M&Ms in his pockets. And it'll come back. Your stomach will grow right back to its original size.
Yeah.
So Nadler, what he did is he just cinched his belt up to his boobs, and then that way he doesn't look fat. I think Gerald Nadler should have been removed from Congress a long time ago.
Yeah.
I don't see how the guy gets elected.
Well, he probably doesn't. I wouldn't be surprised if AOC didn't win her seat either. But I think
it's like Sheila Jackson Lee. She's functionally illiterate. I actually watched her on camera give a payoff in cash to someone in the Kavanaugh hearing on camera. The camera was pointed right at her, and she shook his hand and gave him a fat envelope full of cash.
Damn.
And nothing happens about it.
No, nothing happens. She's functionally illiterate.
Larry was asking, how about Tucker's interview with Devin Archer and the letter that Tucker revealed? So what? I mean, I love you, Larry. I love you to death. But so what? Oh, Hunter Biden is corrupt. Hunter Biden was cutting deals, taking bribes from foreign governments, and giving the money to his dad. We know that already. Tucker interviewing doesn't make any difference. It's literally like a Blade Runner a teardrop in the rain moment. Blake, go ahead.
Yeah. No, what was really interesting about that is that Tucker got the scoop. Tucker did the interview, and nobody else in the media did. And it was interesting. The other thing is that Fox didn't even cover that or use part of that interview to talk about. So it just shows you how bad Fox is. And I guess apparently I heard there was insiders that were really pissed. Well, that's how you cover the news. And they're not.
I'm not going to criticize Fox because they just have me on and they've been good.
But they do some good stuff. Yeah.
I can understand how some people feel that way. And you just have to ask yourself, okay, we've been hearing this for years. Maybe I was a fool for believing it, but that, you know, the mainstream media, they're all going to go away. They're all going to be superseded. And to a great extent, they are. Tucker reaches more people on his Twitter show than all of the news channels combined. But there's still a lot of people out there that are dependent on them. There's still a lot of people that actually watch CNN and think it's real. So as long as that's the case, I mean, what are we doing here? If we're in a chess match, I think it was Phil Godlewski said, oh, you know, it's like a chess match. There's 14 moves left. Both players know that. They can see that. There's only 14 moves left, and then you're going to be in checkmate. And, you know, right, and maybe you put the guy in check two or three times. Okay, great. And he says, we're now at the last move. Well, when are you going to make the move? Why are we waiting? There is no reason to wait. If there's medical cures out there, I know, completely separate from the whole MedBed myth, which may or may not be true. I hope it is. There's cures for diabetes and there's cures for cancer already. Just from the standard chemical kind of stuff that we know how to do. Drugs we know how to make. And they're not being put forward. I mean, how many people are you going to let die before you do something? If there's anybody on our side, please, let's get on with it. I must do this, what, Blake? Six times a year, at least half the time I come on once a month and go, what the fuck is going on? When are we going to do something? And
right, it's a weird psyop because we're supposed to be trusting these people that have been telling us of this. And we're trying to promote that.
Right.
And then they leave us hanging, looking like, yeah.
Yeah. And I think we're all tired of looking like idiots for their benefit. And again, you know, Blake, there's another aspect to this. I know there is a war going on in the military. I know it because my friend got picked up, taken to an airbase last year, if you remember, taken to a southwestern airbase, grilled for 5 days about why he thought Trump was the real commander in chief and the 2020 election winner. So I know this stuff is happening. I know there's a war. I just want to get the war out in the open.
Yeah.
Am I wrong about that, Bruce?
Or? No, you're right. I mean, we've been saying that we're at war. Andrew Breitbart was saying we're at war. But people don't see it because they don't see tanks. They don't see planes. They don't hear explosions in the middle of the night. So they don't know what the war is. But it is a war to destroy this republic. Mm-hmm. When you hear people talking about democracy, states are democracies. States are democracies. That's majority rule. But not the federal government. The federal government is a republic.
Yep.
And the states are like sovereign nations inside this republic.
Yep.
And that's why it's so difficult to keep, because somebody wants all the power.
Well, they lost their sovereignty after the Civil War. That was what state sovereignty was really, that was the issue. It wasn't slavery. That's not what the war was fought over. The war was fought over the original government's Revolutionary War debts to the Rothschild Bank of France at that time. And whether the states were going to be able to be sovereign. And they lost. The Confederacy lost that war. And so they've not been sovereign now since 1871, when they put in place all the laws that made us corporate slaves, which is interesting, secret history of the U.S.
And the same thing happened in 2021 when the American people brought their grievances to Congress and they refused to hear them.
Yeah.
And that's why the Brunson case was originated, because the Congress took an oath and affirmation, a duty in the sixth article of the Constitution to protect our five freedoms, mm-hmm. freedom of speech, freedom to assemble, you know those freedoms. But the fifth one, everybody misses, and that's the freedom to bring grievances against the government.
Yep.
Well, they brought them. And Congress refused to hear them. That's a violation of that oath. So mm-hmm. they deserve to lose their office and be banned from serving in public life again.
Only if somebody enforces it. And right. I guess that's the theme of the night for me. It's only if somebody enforces it. So those of you who have the ability to enforce it, let's get on with it. What are we waiting for? Let's just fucking do it. All right. Okay, one other issue I want to get to before we get on the Ukraine report is kind of a cultural. Okay. I clicked on. Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, so Yasko Gvardiol signed with Manchester City today. So you're just, I'm telling every other club in the world, you're not going to beat Manchester City at anything. don't even play. It's great to be a fan of the best team in the world. I wanted to do another thing sports related. I wanted to ask you about John Gruden, former Super Bowl winning NFL head coach, one of the best coaches, one of the best TV commentators ever on Monday Night Football, is at Saints training camp as an unpaid advisor, which I think is BS. I'm sure he's getting paid under the table. And he swore this week that he is suing the NFL for releasing 13-year-old emails in which he made, wait a minute, did I not share this? I didn't share it. Let's go back. Sorry, guys, my screw up. No worries. I wanted to show you this real quick. Wrong one.
They had email 13 years ago?
They did have email 13 years ago.
Yeah, for the Redskins.
So John Gruden is at Saints training camp. There he is. And the NFL, Roger Goodell specifically, who is a horrible leftard who is ruining American football. And Gruden knows he's ruining American football. He said he swore he's now suing the NFL for illegally, he thinks, releasing these 13-year-old emails to basically run him out of his coaching job with the Las Vegas, formerly Oakland Raiders. And a lot of people think, based on their analysis of the case, that he's going to win. Now, the NFL has lost in court previously to Al Davis, the owner of the Raiders. They've lost. They don't have a lock on this. And I just want to talk to you about Roger Goodell. Roger Goodell is the worst thing that ever happened to football. Football is important. American football is important because it teaches masculinity to young men who can play it, physically take the pain and pounding. It is the best training ground for what life is like and for what being a man is like that any boy can have is playing tackle football with pads and helmets and knees and knee pads on. That's just the way it is. It's a great game. Roger Goodell is feminizing the game. And since he took over, the first thing Goodell started doing in 2007 is he started making a big deal about concussions. Oh, concussions, concussions, concussions. They even made some stupid Will Smith movie, you know, Tell the Truth, where Will Smith pretends to be some Nigerian doctor. Oh, these concussions in football are ruining people's lives. Yeah, well, you know what? That's okay. I'll take a little absent-mindedness in my old age if I can make $50 million playing football when I'm, you know, before the age of 30, which a lot of these guys can. So the point I'm making here is Goodell is the one who started this. Before, you know what they, Brooks, do you remember when you were a kid with the, did you ever play tackle football?
Yeah.
Do you remember what they used to call it when you got a concussion when we were kids? Call it getting your bell rung.
Yeah, getting your bell rung.
Here's your bell rung. Here, tape it up and go back out there, okay? Now they're like, oh, wow, he's a little bit spacey. Oh, well, we better hold him out for the next 6 weeks. It's football. You know, I remember a coach of mine, I said, Coach, I got this horrible headache. And he goes, Barra, football is full of headaches, okay? The point is that Goodell, I guarantee you and that Goodell, who's a creepy libtard lawyer, funneled those settlement cases to law firms of people he was either friends with, went to law school with, knew from his other college days, or were members of his family. You know, cousins, uncles, nephews. I guarantee you, if somebody would investigate that they would find that Roger Goodell is completely corrupt and deliberately funneled billions of dollars of his employer's money, the owners are his employers, to these law firms that I believe you're going to find out he's associated with. And I will happily, I'll say anybody, if I won the $1.25 billion lottery, I'd actually hire somebody to investigate this because I know it's true. So what if we find out that the NFL is just as corrupt, our sports are just as corrupt as our politics? If John Gruden wins this case and he exposes these people, I guess the question, I don't have a question in this. I'm just making a statement. I'm going to get off my soapbox. Blake, do you think anything's going to happen? Let's assume everything I say is correct. Do you think anything's going to happen to these people?
Well, I'd love to see Goodell go down. I can't stand him for a lot of different reasons. And I can't believe the guy makes $40 million or I think it's maybe even more for what? So yeah, it's something dirty going on. I didn't like the vaccine policy that they were pushing. Yeah, it's a bunch of woke garbage. So he seems to be controlled. I do love John Gruden. He is one of the greatest characters, one of the greatest commentators, the greatest coaches. He deserves to be back in. They did him dirty, and I hope he sues the shit out of the NFL for what they did.
Yeah, and I mean, to be fair, there's a couple jokes in there about the size of Maurice.
Guy's lips. But that was personal stuff. Oh, yeah.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I've been in locker rooms. We say shit like that to each other all the time, right to each other's face. The black guys make jokes about the white guys. That's part of football. It's part of being a man, by the way. It's no big deal. Brooks, any thoughts on this at all? Do you have, I mean, I realize that some people don't care about sports, but I think it's a cultural reflection of the battle going on in, it's just as entertainment is, cultural reflection of the battle going on for the soul of this nation.
I have to tell you, I have four kids and two of them played football. I have to tell you that my finest memories raising kids are those October nights where the moon is out there above the stands. The kids are on the field playing. Everybody's on their feet. It's a close game. Everybody's yelling. Everybody's excited. It is what makes high school electric. Mm-hmm. It would just be a prison camp if it wasn't for football. Football is what charges the entire school with money and with excitement and support. Every high school makes money off their football program.
Yep. And, you know, again, I think football is the best education that a preteen and teenage boy can have. I mean, I played it as long as I could. You know, It's funny. I started out as a defensive tackle. Then I was a defensive end. Then I was a linebacker. Then I was a safety. And I'm like, you know, everybody else keeps getting bigger, and I'm staying the same size. And I was like, okay, time for me to get out.
I was a middle linebacker. I loved busting through the line, stepping out three steps, and catching the ball.
Well, I mean, let me tell you, I kind of sucked at football, but at tackle football, padded football. But, you know, every so often you'd make a big play in practice, or you'd beat the top guy, you know, in a one-on-one or something, in a drill, or make a play in a game. And that was the biggest thrill you could have.
At least when
I was a boy. So it was really fun stuff. All right. I just thought that was interesting culturally. And by the way, Star Trek, Strange New Worlds, which is one of the worst shows on television and a complete rape of what Star Trek is. They had a musical episode this week. They already have all these butch, horrible looking women. I was sitting there watching one shot, and there's like a dozen people on the bridge of the Enterprise. So they've made it ridiculously big. And I'm like, nine of them are women. Most of them are black. The only white male is the captain. And I think they only did that because nobody would have watched if they changed him into a gay black, you know, transgender or something. It's phenomenal how our Hollywood culture is so out of touch with what people want. And they don't care. I was on Manorama last night with Ranker Steve. We were talking about this. Like, why are movies from the 80s so great? Because they had natural characterizations of men and women, the way men and right. women really are, and the way men and women should be. So I think that's pretty good. Blake, you got anything you want to add to this before we move on to maybe the last topic of the night?
Yeah, I don't know why they have to ruin that. And, you know, Star Trek was actually pretty groundbreaking with the O'Hara. I believe she was one of the first female black actresses, and that was awesome. That was a milestone. And now they're just throwing it in our face. I don't know if it's for ESG scores or the woke garbage. But why do they have to ruin all this stuff? Why can't they call if somebody something else? So because why do they got to make Superman gay or something?
Well,
why
can't they just make guy it? Deep Space Nine had the first transgender. You remember Dax, who was totally hot, was supposedly a male.
Yeah, that was a weird character. I didn't even get. I still don't understand how that whole thing works, like a shapeshifter or in a different body.
He was a male parasite in a female body. So
yeah. that just shows you. With all that shows you is how long the agenda has been in place.
Yeah.
Is what that shows you. And you're right. The original Star Trek had the best balance. There was Uhura, there were black crewmen, there were black security officers, but it wasn't every single person. I mean, I'm watching Foundation because I remember the Asimov novels, and they've changed like half the characters into women that were men. And like, there's one character, Salvar Hardin, who was a white male, who's now a black woman with a butch, you know, square haircut, who's just hideous. And it's like, you know, she's on screen, you don't even want to look at her. And it's like, it's so distracting that I can't really, there's like, I think there's a good science fiction story in here somewhere, but I can't find it. It's just like, and of course the only, all the evil people are white males. That's the bad people are all white males. Right. We all know that. I think the cultural war is something that we're going to get to. We're just going to have to keep fighting until they give in. All right, let's go to a couple of other things. I'd like you, first of all, to remember to please visit our wonderful sponsors, the CBD Gurus, the CBDGurus.com, where you can get all kinds of cool health products for your health. Go to the wholesale tab, slide down to Mike B. Wholesale, type in the discount code ALIEN. I'm going to type it in right now. No uppercase, no S, ALIEN, and press enter, and you get this week's specials. And not only do you get the cool products, including the immunity booster gummies and the hand lotion or the skin lotion, Lion's Mane products, and the pet products, you can also get 500 Iraqi dinar, 1,000 Iraqi dinar for orders over 100. And 1,500 Iraqi dinar for orders over 150. So these are all cool. Yeah, specials every week. He throws in Venezuelan Bolivar, anything that might be involved in the currency reset if it actually happens. And Brooks, why don't you tell us what's going on over at brooksagnew.com?
Sure. If you can click on that button right there to the left where it says Ivan and Roxy without a prescription, it's right there on the front page. I'm trying to make it easy as I can for you. If you click on that, you can get ivermectin and hydroxychloroquine without a prescription. You've already heard the new head of the CDC coming out saying, you have to have your masks handy. It's coming back. You know, maybe not as bad as it was, but, you know, but I will be honest with you. When I go to conferences, when I get on an airplane and travel, when I'm in a large group of people I don't know, I take my ivermectin every day. That's how you stay healthy. People are mixing and getting together, and they have leprosy in Florida. There's tuberculosis out there. These immigrants are bringing in all kinds of stuff. You need to be protected and keep these parasitics out of your system.
I have a friend, Tama Nugina, back in Pennsylvania, and her kid got into poison ivy, and she started giving him ivermectin, and it cleared up in a couple of hours. So,
oh my goodness,
it works on almost anything. Brooks, also there's the store, and there's the other product that you're
if you go to the
let me see if I can get
health and aging, go to the store. Right there, yeah. Second one down there. Shop.
It's not working from there. Let's go back home, see if we can get it to work. Why is nothing working?
If you hover over store, shop will come up, and you click on shop.
Let me open a link in new tab.
And that should take you. Well,
all right, hang
good
on.
Work.
There we go.
On health and aging.
Health and aging, okay.
And the three products that are really doing well right now, one is True Niagen. That keeps your telomeres long, keeps you from aging. I don't have an affiliate relationship with the company. I tried for a long time, but they have agreed to give my listeners 50% off their first order. So if you click that blue button below the True Niagen, that'll give you 50% off your first order. That'll give you a 90-day supply. If it works for you, great. I can tell you, I miss one day of this and my butt begins dragging my tracks out. I take it every single day, and I'm doing hard physical labor right now, and it's working well for me. The next one is the New Earth Regenesis. Now, I'm in my ninth week on this.
Right.
And the 8th of this month, I'm going for my 6-month checkup. So I've been taking this for about 2 months. The first thing that I noticed is my A1C numbers immediately came down, like almost 30 points.
Wow. I got to get that.
It was a big shift, because what it does, it opens your cells. This works on a micro dose basis with your cells in your body. It opens your cells and allows the sugar to go in your cells. In case you haven't noticed, we run on sugar. Yeah. Our bodies run on it. The way people develop type 2 diabetes is we become mineral deficient. Our cells no longer admit the sugar into the cell, and it just floats around in our bloodstream. And our body says, oh, our sugar's high, and you dump insulin into the system. That's where the type 2 diabetes comes in.
Right.
What this does is it opens up your cells and allows the sugar to go in your cells and run your body. And that drops your A1C. Like within 24 hours of starting this, you'll notice that. But the second thing I noticed, I've been like borderline, my doctor says, borderline kidney disease for, I don't know, 10 years. Mm-hmm. I don't even know what that means. But he knows when I give a urine sample, it's pretty yellow, like as yellow as this Modelo that I've been drinking tonight.
Thanks for sharing that, Brooks. We appreciate it.
But I opened the bottle. It's not okay. Okay, anyway,
that's okay. All right.
First thing I noticed is my pee went clear. And I cannot wait for the 8th. I'm going to go, and she's going to say, what have you? Oh, and I've also lost 11 pounds in, 9 weeks. So this is very good stuff.
Wow. Okay, I need some of that. I need some of that. And again, I'm really anxious to try that, Brooks. And I'm going to buy it through you.
That's the way to get it.
I got a lot of stuff going on. I'm going to kind of wait until we move. You know, somebody said Celtic sea salt is great too. So I'm...
I can get other things too. I can get other medications because I'm linked up with a pharmacy in Japan. So,
Yeah.
If you get any other medication that you're getting other than narcotics or insulin, I can usually get it cheaper and get it without a prescription. So if you're tired of paying your doctor his cut, just get it without a prescription.
Yeah. One thing I want to ask you about, though, is if I start taking that, should I maybe not take my blood sugar meds? Because then what if my blood sugar goes too low?
Well, if it goes low, you'll find right out because you won't be able to get out of the chair.
Yeah.
Because you run on sugar. So if you're already nuking the sugar that you're putting in your system with chemicals, that means your cells can't access it anymore. And that's harmful to you. So you don't want to run out of sugar. That's type 1 diabetes where you go into insulin shock.
Yeah. I'm looking for, Zeke was asking me about, where is it? He was asking me about digestive enzymes. And I had some issues with nausea. And and so he said, try this super enzymes when you eat a meal. And there is a thing with diabetes where your stomach doesn't digest the food fast enough, and then you feel really awful, and you feel like you got constant indigestion. And so I started using these super enzymes. It's from Now, I think, is the company, Now, N-O-W. And I'm just gonna tell you, that shit worked great. So if you have any issues like that, try it out. It should work really well. It worked really well for me. And thank you, Zeke, for that. There's so many things I want to be on, Brooks, but like I said, I'm thinking if I go on that stuff, and what's it called again,
New Earth Regenesis.
Yeah, New Earth Genesis or
Earth Regenesis.
New Earth Regenesis.
It is a patented formula. You do 5 drops under the tongue in the morning, about, I don't know, 30, 40 minutes before you eat breakfast. And man, what a difference.
Okay.
You don't feel anything from it because it's on a cellular level. It's a microdose. It works with your cells directly. Right. It doesn't go into your bloodstream. Well, it goes into your bloodstream because you put it under your tongue. You don't digest it. And then it accumulates in your cells.
Well, I've got to try it. I've got to try both those. They both sound great. And do they do anything for, little Brooks?
I don't know because I'm not active that way.
we need to fix that problem, Brooks. All right.
That's another issue altogether.
Those are some cool things to try for people. And, between the CBD gurus, between what Brooks has got going there with Regenesis and all this stuff, let's see if we can get everybody back on track. And that's why I say, Brooks, there's so many things that could be released and publicly acknowledged. Like if people went and tried Regenesis, if there was clinical studies and they said, this stuff works great, take this and a lot of problems will go away. A lot of pharmaceutical companies would be upset by that, wouldn't they?
Oh, yeah. Well, we can't say that. I mean, I say I treat and cure and prevent the disease of ignorance, but you can't say anything beyond that.
All right, let's go to the final report. We'll get an update from you. Let me go to our different background. Why don't you give us a Ukraine update? Because some people are saying this war is damn near over. McGregor said, I think we just discussed it last week, they have about 2.5 divisions left or something like that.
About 30,000 trained troops. And the Russians are... are the DPR. The DPR is the Russians living in Donetsk and in the Donbass. They're not from Russia, but they're taking Ukrainian and British and American machines that they're taking over, not the Abrams because they haven't taken it over there yet, but tons of I think it's the T-67 tank. Mm-hmm. And the Bradley fighting vehicles and stuff like that. And they're taking them over, repainting them, and using them against the Ukrainians. And these guys have been fighting since 2014.
Yeah.
These are highly trained people, and they're in the field, and they're being successful. Anyway, one of the things most people don't know is that the Wagner group moved into Belarus, which is about an hour away from Kiev.
Right.
I thought that they would just take the hour and head to Kiev. I maintain that a lot of them have, just not in uniform. They're in Kiev and they're waiting for orders. But one of the things the Russians did do as a force is they attacked from the north. And this is devastating because what it's doing, it's splitting the Ukrainian forces in two, and they can't resupply. The other thing that they did, and I know you heard it in the news, but you don't really realize how profound this is they put an embargo on all ships coming into Odessa, all ships coming into the ports. Doesn't matter what they bring in. They say they're bringing in something, and then they're taking grain out, and they're trying to make it out into be a big a grain embargo, but it's not. I mean, that's the effect of it. But what they're doing is preventing the weapons from coming in. That's how the weapons were coming in. They were coming in disguised as toys or manufacturing goods. And then they were offloading them and then filling up with grain and then leaving. And the Russian spies figured it out. And they just said, okay, fine. No ships get in. So that's why this war is soon going to be over. It could be over by the end of August. Literally.
Yeah. McGregor is saying that the Ukrainians are actually now walking up and surrendering to the Russians.
The Russians are sending out in two languages, sending out in Ukrainian and also in English, every 15 minutes on all airwaves, that if you'll just lay down your weapons and come, we will make sure you're freed. You know, you're.
Yeah,
a farm and a ranch. We don't want to fight you. This is not about land. It's about people.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, let's hope that it's over very, very soon. Okay. TV's Blake Wally, any final thoughts or other issues you'd like to bring up before we head out for our weekend?
Yeah. Well, I hope that war is over, and I hope they are surrendering if they need to. They're being thrown into a meat grinder. A lot of those guys aren't trained well, and yeah, they're just... getting picked off. And the other thing I got to mention is people had to make some noise for Gonzalo Lira. He's a political prisoner. Yes.
I hadn't heard from him since he was 3 kilometers from the Hungarian border.
Wow.
Yeah, I think he's been picked up, unfortunately, by the SBU. So he's captured again. He had no choice. He knew it was going to be a kangaroo court, and he'd be dying in prison 5 to 8 years. He was going to get sentenced, or he can try to flee for Hungary. Unfortunately, I don't know if he made it there or if they refused his asylum. We haven't got that side of the story yet.
Well, one thing he did mention in his video is that Victoria Nuland is aware of him and hates his guts.
So
I'm sure that she called ahead to the border and said, when he gets there, just hold him. Our guys will come pick him up.
Yeah, probably. Yeah.
I'm surprised the Hungarians didn't let him in, to be honest.
Me too. I am very surprised because, you know, he was saying, look, this is my last chance. You know, I'm smoking a few cigarettes here, making this video. I'm going to get on my motorcycle and I'm going to ride for the Hungarian border. He's literally 5 minutes from the border, and we never heard from him again.
Wow.
No.
I know a girl in Hungary. Her name is Judith. The only problem is I married a girl who was Hungarian. Her name was Judith. So I'm not going there. But Hungary's country I'd like to visit. Maybe someday.
I like Viktor Orban. I think he's got his head screwed on straight.
Yeah.
And I think had he known about it, he would have gone to the border himself and got Gonzalo Lira. You know why they jailed him? For speech. They're going to kill him for his YouTube channel.
Yeah.
Fuck you, Victoria Nuland. Fuck you.
Well, there you go. Brooks laying it on the line. All right. if that's it, a couple things I just want to share. Do not forget that don't want you to forget that I'm going to be going to the Edinburgh UFO conference in 2 weeks, actually next Friday. So yeah, there will not be a show next week. I'm glad there was one this week because I'm going to be in Edinburgh for the UFO Festival, August 11th and August 12th. It's really fun. It's cute. I don't know how it'll be in the heat of August. When I was there in April of last year, it was great. you guys got to check out the the guest speakers page. Oh, maybe they fixed some of this stuff because I'm going to be there. David Childress is going to be there. Mark D'Antonio is going to be there. Noe Torres, Stanley Milford. and Daniel Jones is going to MC. But earlier they had the pictures all messed up. It seems like they fixed the picture. they actually had Childress was actually Stanley Milford, or it was all messed up. Okay, so that's cool, and it's all fixed. But I will be there next Friday, so no show next Friday. There's George Norrie; he came a few years back. And then also, I want to remind everybody of the September 14th through 17th Alien event at the Alexis Park Resort in Las Vegas, Nevada. I will be moved there and living there by now. I'm going to be there. Dr. Brooks Agnew is going to be there. Brooks, are you going to be calling in or flying in?
I'm flying in. I'll be there. Absolutely.
And Andy Basiogo, Brad Olson, one of my buddies, is going to be there. Laura Eisenhower is supposed to be there. And again, I don't know if she's calling in or flying in, but you know, you got to get them in there. And then some other people, I don't know who they are, but, you want to come, you want to hang with me, you want to hang with Brooks, you want to hang with Brad, you want to hang with Laura. We're the cool cats. Come see us at the Alien event at the Alexis Park Resort, Las Vegas. And you can use a discount code Mike Barra when you buy tickets. So please, 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 please. Please make sure you do that. I don't know what's going on with my voice. I'm going through puberty again or something. So, all right, guys. Any last final thoughts, predictions? Anybody have any predictions? My prediction that XRP would go over $1 this week died a death. And I actually went down by about 10 cents. I said that because it's part of the, it's part of the financial process. So my understanding, just for the information Nancy and some other people were asking, is that the financial process was stopped because of an illness that turned out to be an assassination attempt. And supposedly everything has been agreed upon again. Certain actors are scheduled to leave the stage. Let's hope that's what we know it is, but that's now been put off till Thursday. Well, to my mind, Brooks, Thursday just gives them another chance to come up with some other dirty trick to pull to get out of it. But I'm going to come back and say again, once the financial thing starts moving, I think XLM and XRP are going to go up. That's my prediction. I'm still saying, I'll say it again for the third week in a row, XRP gets to $1 by next Friday, because I do believe there's going to be some movement on the financial end. TV's Blake Wall, you got a prediction for us this week. And by the way, do we remember what our predictions were last week? Mine's the same, so I can always remember it. What's your prediction?
My last week's prediction, I think I had, I remember I had Dianne Feinstein stepping down. I think she had some power. She's not stepping down from Congress, but I think her granddaughter is taking over her financial affairs or something. Oh, like she's going to be a fiduciary. So it's kind of a partial step down, kind of close. But on my prediction this week, I have to actually disagree with you, Mike. Unfortunately, not necessarily on the XRP or singling that out, but there are some major issues going down with the crypto right now. We have the largest DeFi protocol, Curve. Major problems. That's cracking at the seams. You've got Binance, the largest exchange, that could be potentially going down. There's also Tether, the biggest stable coin, which has never really been fully audited. There's a lot of things happening with crypto. And I'm a big pro crypto guy, but there's too many things.
You think the crypto market overall is going to go down over the next week?
If Binance, or I think Curve might hang on for a little longer. They were able to pick up a little bit of their crypto cartel money, some big investors.
Right.
Issue without getting too much into the weeds. But Binance, if that goes down, or if the Tether stablecoin goes down, that's going to be huge. That's going to rock the market in a bad way.
Yeah, well, I agree with you. But I think what's going on is the weeding out process, where there's only going to be a few cryptos left. And that's why I expect XRP to go up. So actually, Blake, in the long run, if that happens, I think that's good for my prediction. Maybe not by Friday, but that's what's going to happen with XRP and XLM and the few technologies, blockchain technologies, that do survive. So
yeah, I agree with that. Long term, great. Yeah, they got to flesh out some bad actors in that space. And then maybe BlackRock's taking it down because they want to drive the price down, scare everybody out of the markets. And they're going to swoop in if they get their approval on their ETF.
And that reminds me, Sam Bankman-Fried, or whatever his name is, completely walked on the default of the Silicon Valley Bank, and no charges, no nothing, because he contributes to Democrats. So it just continues to show you how corrupt everything is. All right, Dr. Brooks Agnew, do you have a prediction for between now? Well, it's going to be at least 2 weeks before we do another show, but what's your prediction?
Well, I'm predicting a move in silver. I sold about 20 pounds of silver this week. It got up there a little bit, and I am building a house, so I'm building it out of my
backyard. So you got 2 2x4s for that?
No, I was able to get the whole roof system.
Cool.
But I predict silver is going to be bumping up against $30 in the next 2 weeks.
All right. That'd be great. I got a lot of silver, too. So, all right. Before we go, I just got a text message. Brooks, I just got a text message from Rick Springfield. He called from 1986 and he wants his shirt back. Remember, Rick used to be on it. All right, guys, that is going to wrap it up. Everybody have a great weekend. I will be back on Monday with Jen. Jen and I will be back on Monday for the Real News Live. What do we call it?
Monday Update.
Monday Gentel Show is all we call it. We're going to be back then. Brooks and Blake and I will be back in 2 weeks because I'm going to be in Edinburgh next week, as I just told you. Get your tickets for that if you're in the Texas area, or better yet, come to Las Vegas and see me and Brooks and Brad and Laura and have a great time. I can guarantee you one thing. If Laura's there, there's going to be drinking and we're going to have a good time in Las Vegas.
No, show up there. Not much anymore.
Let's enjoy ourselves. Blake, keep rocking and rolling, buddy. We love you. And, everybody have a great weekend. I'll see you back here on Monday, and the Power Trio will be back in 2 weeks with a with a new Power Trio video. We're running out of Power Trios. There's not that many.
Emerson, Lake, and Palmer, but
ones that I like. I don't like Rush. I went to a Rush concert once. It was like, my girlfriend made me go. It was like listening to somebody. It was like listening to a bandsaw on metal. It just was. Anyway, all right. Love you guys. We'll be back in 2 weeks. Everybody have a great weekend. Peace out. All right.
Thanks.